So, so yeah, you know, everything starts at the ring. Of course, we're all right. Seriously, this one is great. So, what we like to coach, we had that meeting last week. This is one of the main topics that we do when we get to meetings. Let me start out here real quick. So, what we like to tell everybody, think about it. Stance sometimes can be overweight. Those are pressurized stance. I believe stance, there, you can have an open stance, you can close stance, you can have a lot of different things because here's the key phrase. Nothing happens in a softball swing. That's what I'm focusing on. Nothing happens because, and then, but from that point, everything has to come on this. And that's what we want. It's a timer. All of our timing, first we have to time the pitch itself, and then, you know, that's when our brain can get all the apex. And what's our number one rule?
Trigger strikes.
Okay, so at the apex, we have to decide number one, who is right, because we're professionals and results. And number two, where is it on the plate, so what am I going to do? Right? Both of you want to chance the other direction. So then it's how I react. Now, our eyes, this is the important thing. This is where sometimes stance can be. I tend to like when we have interest a little bit more than not for us as senior players to have a slight deal. Any movement, but not the swing, is even starting, right? Maybe we're breaking down the idea, but that pitch is another timing mechanism that you want to go along. Right? Second level pitch. So we want to start left hand back up here. Okay, now. This is what we need to do. Where this is the easiest way that I found. warm up. These arms are really the delivery. You don't really want to overthink the arms. The hands are important. Those are the areas where my answer is a different question. He's been working on lower half, got that down, a little bit of issues with where my hands were. So this is kind of a broad overview. Another great question. What we don't want to have happen, we had a guy this weekend who was doing that. We call it the arm bar. You know, you have UFC fights, you know how they do the arm bar, they pull a guy and they're going to snap it out of socket, okay? That's what they call it, an arm bar. What that is, it's an overextension of the arm, right? So that's what Bob and I named it this. If we get to arm bar too soon in our swing, watch what happens. So what it means is I get to extension all the way back here. Okay, I basically, you know, I'm over exaggerating, so you can see a negative effect. But if I get to extension out here too soon, I'm literally kind of pulling the back of the ball. I'm negating the snap of my wrist. I'm negating my out arm. It's not letting it karate chop. I've extended it too soon. Look, am I going to karate chop the pitcher now? Can't. You know now because of your new knowledge today that I got to karate chop the pitcher. It's a simple motion. If I arm bar too soon, get out here, can't do that. What happens? Usually loss of power, obviously, definitely loss of power. Okay, you tend to swing around the ball because you're extended too soon. And a lot of times for us righties, it turns into some balls hit down in here and more ground balls than we want to hit. Because we're swinging around the ball, we understand how we're actually hitting the ball if the bat's coming back this way instead of getting it out this way and snapping. Usually our bat plane goes to the top half of the ball, and we tend to get more ground balls. So we don't want to do that. We want to make sure that we can. This arm here kind of stays tucked until extension out here. When it reaches out here. That's where we get our most bat. Well, I mean, we remember, nothing should ever feel tense. It stands or strong. It should feel natural. So when I say tuck, it should be back in here. Remember, where are my key thing here too is at starting point, where are my elbows? If my elbows had a camera lens, I'd be taking a picture of the ground. So here's the we don't want this. The biggest thing I hear, I love, I told you guys, they go to the ballpark and I shut everything out. I just go through four fields. I have a plan. This is great. I don't have to play, I'm just gonna watch this all. Coming in 9.5 miles an hour, I have to create the power. So you see why the technique of slow pitch softball hitting, obviously there's a lot of similarities in baseball, but there are some specific differences that if you don't correct, you'll never reach the potential of the that's one of the things. So, get back to the original thing. So where do my arms need to go? I'm here, I'm back up again. Now watch, this arm's going to body chop, this arm's going to follow through the wall. I say this elbow kind of has to be tucked a little bit. But when we're down here taking a picture of the ground anyway, right? It's almost, this forearm is almost parallel to my chest in this position. If I'm back up and in, it's close to parallel. But now, we'll slow it down, slow it down, slow it down. No extension. Boom, I'm in extension. Right before impact. Finished part of the hands. 1986. How big was the New York City Yellow Jackets? 1986. How thick? Huge, right? Now see, when I'm coaching a young 25-year-old, I can't even use the story to show you the way the Yellow Jackets is, right? Okay, they're like, oh, Google. When you're swinging properly in softball, you must swing through New York City Yellow Pages, not two. That's another thing, way that we fall. The other three words I call is finished. So many people, I'll see, they'll dive the ball right back out of half. They get to here, and then they just kind of follow through, but they really don't finish the swing. Our fastest point of basket, remember, none of this happens just by accident. The reason we're talking so much today is I need to educate you guys so you know what you're going to try to do, right? If I just show you, you won't learn as quickly as if I talk about it. It's the back of our head of education. We got to bring it to the front of the brain anyway, so that when I'm pitching these balls, we're going to try to do it. Kids, I teach them. But I have to have in my mind that my most explosive part of the swing is swinging through the ball, finishing that swing, finishing that rotation. I throw it all the way around here. So that everybody's taking a picture. I'm fully rotated. I squish this bug. He's dead or shit. There's guts gone everywhere as I rotate it. Right? So that's where we get to that. We finish the swing.
Not so much the shoulder staying in and then going, because you're right here.
No.
It's not this.
Let me show you another thing. There's always, this is what I call systems check. Okay? We have a system of swings. There's many different ways that we can check a particular body position by checking the rest of the system. Okay? So, your point was, you're asking great questions. This shoulder here also must not get over 30 too soon. And the reason that it happens most of the time, I think I've asked you guys about the exercise. You saw the exercise, right? Do the exercise. Let me spin your head around. That you cannot hit effectively, consistently, like this. See how my head went that way? What have I talked about? The golf swing. That's one familiar thing in golf. It's an easy game, ball sitting there, you don't have to move. I mean, that's why we all score under par. So anyway, good golf coach, one of the first things he'll teach you is my head is on the ball, my backswing, my head's on the ball, my head's still on the ball's gone. I've not told you this here. Head on ball, right? My three-word thing for there, remind me that. My biggest issue that I continue to do. Trapezius muscle, this shoulder. Watch this shoulder now. Get back to your question. Watch this shoulder now. If my head just slightly, so even if people don't way drastically overdo it, most people, there's some people that'll drastically overdo it. They're like this, and they're doing the other one, like looking at the ball. Remember peripheral vision? They're seeing the eye of one ball, one eye. This eye's on the ball, this eye's gone. Okay? Most of the time, what I find people doing is they track the ball with their head, meaning they follow the ball flight with their head. That's not watching the ball through it. Watch what this looks like. I'm going to hit the ball and left hand through that hole, and I'm going to watch the ball with my head instead of the way it's supposed to. So watch, this is how it looks. Ball's coming in. Look at it. You can get a lot of hits like that. My object is to hit 1,000. If I can play you 10 pitches in a row, exactly in the same place, and I ask you to swing like that, you might get 6 or 7 line drives like that. You might get 5 or 6. You're going to miss hits of balls. However, if you can discipline yourself to do this, watch head position. Where my head is. Shoulder, where the ball was. Now, all of a sudden, you're hitting 7 or 8 balls pure. You can buy one hit a weekend as a batter, as a rookie. So, to get back to your thing, when your head goes too soon, because you're following the ball flight, this shoulder slightly goes with it. Watch. Now, this shoulder should be driving towards the ball, and then only exploding after, you know, at impact or through impact. It's all straight, everything into the ball, and then instead of watching, my head doesn't follow, my shoulder starts going that way almost immediately. Okay, before impact. Keep teaching today. Any movement before impact, moving anywhere other than that way, is potentially counterproductive. Physics, simple physics. We want every bit of our body going that way, whoever pushing the ball. Okay? So after impact, you know, when I rotate, then yeah, I've got body motion going that way, right? Because I've torqued so much. Yeah, man, I'm going that way. But this shoulder opens before impact when the head doesn't stay on the ball. So it does a bunch of things. First of all, both eyes aren't fully on the ball. You actually slightly decrease the length of your barrel, because if you think about it, you're pulling away from the ball when that shoulder's going there. This 34-inch bat becomes a 33-inch bat. Okay. So what do? I shorten my lever instead of lengthening my lever. Longer lever, more leverage. I'm shortening my lever to begin with. Eyes coming off the ball. You see all those double negatives? Look, you can get the beauty of slow pitch softball. You can do a lot of things wrong and still get a hit. I mean, that's why it's a great game. Like, seriously, people bring their grandmas out and throw them enough pitches, and sooner or later they're going to connect one and shoot. And I'm not making fun of that. I have nothing better than I like seeing. There's little T-ball guys playing and older people playing in some beer game or whatever, and they're just happy as hell to touch the ball. It's a great game. And we're out to perfection. We're at a different level. You're new, you are. You want to get better. This is the way to get better. There's no way you can dispute it. The better our technique is, the more successful we are at getting on base. Simple as that. You can leave now, you write the notes down. I've told you this too. You leave now, never touch a ball, you're better right now because of this.
Now, my question is time. So, my decision appears to be a split second.
Right? Yes, sir.
So, stance, the ball's coming in my eye. I'm looking at the thing, I'm swinging right here. When I look at the video, right here.
Yeah,
hit the shit out of it.
No, well, look, you're 6'12" and you weigh 300 pounds, okay? I told you, there's a reason God didn't make me or something.
It wouldn't
be fair for anybody else. It wouldn't be fair for anybody else. I love you, okay? But, again, you can get away with a lot and still get hit, but we want to get an actual dollar at a time. It could be a slight depth perception issue. Have you had your eyes checked like that?
Oh,
do it. It might be. It could be something as simple as that. I'm going to tell you, in baseball, you're coaching, you know, kids that are having problems, you know, good athletes have problems with outfields. obviously, we want to get an extension, right? The other thing with timing is, you know, I've laid out the impact zone. There is the farther, and I only talk about strikes in the ball, so we're anticipating it's going to be a strike in the plate. The farther inside the pitch is on this third of the plate as a strike, the farther out here I must attack the ball to connect because I won't get to extension otherwise. Now, I know with you, sometimes those inside pitches like that, your greatest power is in here and here, and a lot of times it's because you're letting balls get to. And they're like, so it sounds dumb, but everybody has, and this is our own thinking in our head sometimes that we don't even think about, but we think about it after I explain it. So, if your bat speed matches 8 miles an hour, your bat speed is 8 miles an hour, inside pitching, you can't flip a switch, a nitrous switch, you're going to be caught. It's not in you. Your maximum batting is in. Therefore, the elementary part of timing, what the most elementary part of timing is what? It's when we start our swing. Right? That's kindergarten timing is, remember, identifying pitch, strike ball, where I'm going to go. That's elementary timing. When we get into the more details, it's timing of where should my hands be, where should my hips be, where should my feet be. That gets, that's a little more timing. Right? But what we're talking about is elementary timing. I've got to simply start my swing with a millisecond sooner. It's that simple. There is no nitrous switch to hit. Okay? There's no turbo. You don't got one. There ain't. There's never going to be more than 80. Okay? So right now, but that's our fallacy in our head, that we see that inside pitch. Our brain doesn't, you know, unless you know and you don't practice it, you don't start swinging any earlier than you do with this pitch, and then what happens? You end up hitting it back here. You hit the impact zone, but it didn't get full extension. And guys, you know, you all, I call it hitting the ball pure. It's great. When you hit a ball pure, you know it. You know, if you've got fully extended, you hardly even feel that ball in the back, it just takes off. And sometimes it's not even a full swing, 70%. You know if you hit a ball pure. That's what we're after. That's why we're here. More pure balls we can hit, the more we're going to be on base. Simple as that.
Is there any game in the
third? I've seen 12 this year. Well, actually, remember, nothing happens in the swing until the foot is here. Around. Yes.
Yes. And it's your hand.
Well, hips and knees are tied together. Now. Hips starts to rotate, hands starts to go. Hips slightly ahead of hands. What? Remember, where's the most? Why? Rotational power is 85% of our potential power. Lateral power is 15%. Doesn't it make sense that this has to start a tiny bit quicker? Don't overthink it. Think that it's here, then you're pissed. We're exaggerating, but we can overthink things, but if you slow-moded in camera and you hit a pure ball and you isolated your hips, you would probably see that I'm gonna try to slow-mo. Okay, so I'm here. Location of body weight is already started until a second before this. Well, the lateral movement happened, okay, because I'm down on the foot. I shouldn't be any more lateral than now because once that foot is around, it needs to stay there, right? So whatever lateral movement I did, that's been done.
Correct? If I remember right, it's just 95.5. It's supposed to.
Well, 95% of weight is on just that foot. 5%
here. They're still there, and there's that still
the translocation, I call it translocation power.
Just to hear a little bit.
So let's do it again. We go to super slow.
Can I ask?
Yeah, super slow. So that's the lateral. Nothing else moved yet. Why? Because nothing happens until that foot hits the ground. Now, the first motion will be this.
Yeah.
This starts. slightly before the hands. It's, now, it's not... That's too much. I over-exaggerate. But the very first motion you'll get is the beginning rotation of this hip. And then, I like to say, the faster you spin, the harder and harder it goes. So at that point, you know, while we're intent on doing is getting this hip right here, slightly higher. See, it's not a lot, it's just a little bit. But that's like college timing. You remember we had the elementary timing? That it goes all the way like that. Hitting a ball goes from elementary school to graduate school with our timing of events and our body positions, right? That makes sense? Out water because my water was disgusting. And we're going to start
hitting.
Makes sense when he's done.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
So.
I got this in too much. I got to get it out. I've been in here and then trying to get it up. I start out here. We're doing something right.
You hit
him.
Nice. Pulled
that
nice one.
I don't know what it went, but Beth said to me later, he says, he's
on that one.
And I was like, all right, yeah, I'm just not real sure what I did.
What we might end up doing today, depending on what I see, is it's really good if you want to really isolate a position. The best thing to do is a controlled environment. Not gonna suckle right there. And the greatest way of breaking down a certain position at a certain time and really helping you spin your head on where I should be.
I don't have a problem.
Well, you're going to. I just want to kind of see. I want you guys to take like 10 swings just to get loose. In a lesson, I usually don't like starting people in the team unless I tell them to take the swings. I kind of like to see what they're dealing with before I get to that. I might see some other things. Probably not what you're doing. We'll probably go into that pretty quick.
I have an idea.
Shit yourself. Do I need to get my couch out or just bench?
Just down. One.
Thank you. you did wrong. Number one, I'll show you the footwork in a second. Step too far across your body. When you step this far across your body, you can't rotate. Basically, you negated a majority of your lower half power. When you got to the ball, you did not finish your swing. The reason you didn't finish your swing is you're fighting your body. When you step like this, you can't rotate. So it makes you not fully be able to do this and finish your swing. So in my eyes, I see it in slow motion. To me, it looks like you did this and you stopped and your back kind of ended up over there as compared to this when you rotate properly. Understand? So yeah, we can't step in too far this way.
Yeah, so every time it looks like I'm here, but I'm...
Yeah, that's where you want to be. Your front foot should be coming straight ahead like here, 85% of the time. Step towards the pitcher. but people get the wrong idea, because really, if I step to a picture, it really look like this, right? And that's not what we want to do. We want to step straight ahead of this foot, okay? Whether I start here, or I start here, or I finish, it needs to be right here. So if I have an open stance or a closed stance, that's where my foot needs to end up. I like to tell people, the dirt is your best report card. Clean your landing area. By yourself with a batting tee, checking the footwork. Now I can see, you've set the box, don't really go. 10 balls coming, watch the ball, shoot it out. Every time, that's where your foot should be. The only difference is when we overreact. When we usually overreact, now, of course, we are professional hitters, we swing strikes only. But what if you have a 1-1 count and you take a strike? And the next ball, congratulations, right here. We got to swing at that, right? Well, let's say it's right there. We got to swing at that, right? Too close. And we can still, now remember, if you're swinging at balls, we know that something in your technique has to suffer. Those, we can still pretty much get 99% right if our footwork is here. What we think is because it's here that I must do this. When I do this, this hip gets committed right from the beginning. I lose my power before I even start swinging. Because remember, nothing happens in the swing until this foot hits the ground. Okay, so my foot hits the ground, my hands are still here, right? We learned that when I did the super slow mo for you. Now, try to hit. I have to hit. Totally upper body, right? I've rotated way too soon. I've overreacted to this pitch. What do I need to do? What you just did, which is get out there a little quicker. That barrel head out here. Okay, here's my regular foot, right? Here's where I end up here. So the rule of thumb is, you draw a line to your midstep from this toe. Alright, this is my midstep. Have I overstepped my foot? You can make an adjustment of foot length, but not more. Okay? Now, let's say it's the outside pitch. Everybody wants to do this, right? Overstep it. Absolutely good. Now what's going to happen? What's my hip going to do? What you were doing. No way you can rotate. You're going to be taking a picture of the second baseman if you're lucky. Again, I'm negating my lower half. What's okay for that pitch? I can do this. Still on the toe, right? I've never given up my feet. Understand? The fallacy in our head is we think we have to reach far for that ball because it's outside, right? How big is his back?
34.
How big is mine on? 26? What's 26 and 34? 60 inches, right? I've got 60 inches of reach. Gary, hey, how did it feel hitting up the tee? Okay? We'll fix that. I've got 60 inches of reach. Can I cover the whole plate without doing any of that? I'm still way over there. If I can do this, I'm still over there. Now, I am thinking that I got to step into it because it's outside. We don't have that link. We don't have those levers. He does. Those three lines in the plate, he could cheat a little bit more than we can. Generally speaking, and then we're going to go to you, the giant. Here's our, what I call the middle line, right? This comes off the point of the plate, up the middle. Okay? Guys around our size, usually, you know, something like this, okay? Because we have to cover the short pitch, and we have to cover the middle line, okay? Now, always told you guys, take an eye and look at the pitcher in the face here, and see if he can pick up a pattern. See if he's pitching more back and forth. It's more important for us than him. First thing, you're starting way back in here, and you're up here. Balls that are coming in here at the plate, every single time that you're doing, your first movement is dropping your hands because you've got to go all the way down there. Where's powerful coming softball? Comes from the ground. But what is our most powerful pitches? Chest to go. That's power softball. Baseball. Trying to hit like a baseball player. You're negating a lot of your size by standing way back in here. You're letting in, on top of it, you're further negating it because you're letting balls get down instead of hitting them up here where your power is. You start hitting balls in here, you're going to hit stuff that people are down there wanting to hit. I'm not saying you can't hit balls back there. I'm talking about consistency. Okay? So with you, for sure, no more than middle. You might even find yourself up in here a little bit. But you can certainly start here. I don't ever want to see that. Should ever be like that. But you got your hands here, so your first movements are, I was going to tell you to watch his hands, but you wouldn't know what to watch for. Your first movements are, you drop your hands early, and you're bringing it back up to here and back, and then you're swinging. That all happens in half a second. I don't want to see any of it. Watch this. Remember, our object is the least movement, right? And going this way. So I'm going to take an easy swing for you. I want you to tell me if you see any movement at all going there, there, or there, or even there. We want all the movements to go here. So this is another reason why if we start it back up again, we should be there. first movement was dropping the hands, bringing the hands back up, up, and then swing. Timing, right? Something else to go wrong. Okay? Slows your swing down. What about, and see, here's the thing. If you mistime the ball and you don't have time to pull your bat back to where it should have been to begin with, are you getting, let's simplify it. If you have, I don't know how many inches, but let's say we have 32 inches to go back to. Okay, from here to the ball. And I don't know if that's the right move. But if you, because your hands are up front, never get back to here, and you only use 30 inches, do you ever get to your maximum bat speed? If it takes you 32 inches in that proper form to get to 80 miles an hour on your potential, are you ever going to get to 80 miles an hour if your hands aren't in position to begin? Makes sense? Never going to happen. So, this might feel weird in your posture and stance, but you got to start out back up in here. It just simplifies the swing. It's like this place. Some guys have gotten to where they were straight up and down guys. The only way they could figure it was we overemphasized the movements, they could get it, and they've gotten comfortable laying the bat on their shoulder. I don't even mind that.
That's a good thing to tell me.
Correct.
But what I mean is, you know, exaggerate this as opposed to this. Just somewhere within here, where you want to be, that's fine.
Yeah. But you want that barrel back a little bit. You don't want it up and down, because then you have to do this. This, sometimes you drop the barrel too much, wasn't due to your swing plane. Now you're swinging up. And it makes your swing feel kind of loopy. Because a lot of times our hands get in here and their swings are like that. And we don't want that. We just want simple, flat, clean, hard swing. So I have my bat slightly like this to begin with. And I've worked on this the last couple years myself. I used to find myself doing this a lot. Look, I know. I can flatten my bat out a little bit to get the plane. I'm just slow dropping. I'm there. You understand the bat angle? Let's check your posture. Hip flops. Always, when you're doing that when you can, you always want to orientate yourself to what it is you're going to do in the game. So whenever you can, even if you're working at home on a tee and you don't have a plate, you're working in your backyard and doing that, put down a hand towel so you can orientate yourself. Tell me the difference. You got that bat in your hand. You can tell the turbo in that. You got that bat in your fingers. Now, what is it? Swing. Now, you notice the difference in the swing? See any other movement? Now go ahead and take an aggressive swing. Find the ball and swing like you're going to swing. See how much better that looks? Raised a little bit.
Now?
I want to throw it
done that before. You were missing that ball. I'm telling you, that's so much better. 27 seconds.
Wow.
mile-an-hour wind blowing straight in. See, how'd that feel? Very similar to the other one, right? Watching the ball come in from the pitcher should be so intent. That's what you're looking for. When I did the thing this weekend, I talked about the ball zone. I call the ball zone that area around the ball when it's leaving the pitcher's hand, coming in. And a lot of times when you really think about it, and I got a lot of people there to think about it, they're really watching the ball zone. Really not intently focusing on the ball itself. We must watch the ball itself. Not, again, eye-hand coordination is a great thing. How many times you swing and miss and slip and slide? Not so often. You can look at the ball zone and hit a ball almost every time. That's the good news. The bad news is you're going to hit it almost every time. The other bad news is, are you going to hit it consistently in the middle of the ball like we're after? The answer to that is that you're not going to hit it as consistently as if you would focusing on the ball. Again, you can learn one little thing today that helps you get one more hit in a game or one more hit in a weekend. It's worth it. You get better. Swing it better. You guys are both at a level now, probably not going to make drastic changes. It's bringing it all together, and then once in a while, you can all get out of sync and you too. Guys are building towards what I call your softball identity. You've really got to work on those hands. Because as much as we say the stance isn't as important, when the stance is making someone have a bad habit, it can become important. When your hands are out in front of you, your swing is totally different than your hands are out.
So you saw an improvement on the timing?
Didn't you see how many balls? Now answer me truthfully. After we made that change, and remember a couple times you went back to your childhood.
Yeah.
But did you or did you not hit the ball more square and pure?
Yeah, I did. There were some that I just
are we automatically going to hit everything perfect? No, but it's the step in the direction, because what are we trying to do? We're trying to get proper muscle. Right? If you don't learn where I should be, where's my foot be, where's my hips be, where my hand. Shouldn't be like before. That's what we're at. And again,
Gretzky, most dominant hockey player that I've seen in my lifetime, I think. Michael Jordan. I think Tiger Woods, when he was in his heyday in his prime, dominated that sport, which I think is one of the three hardest sports that nobody ever did. So I always would use, you know, how many times a week did Tiger Woods practice with a swing coach watching him? Practice every day, that was perfect. Now what we're going to do is we're going to check to see if everything's working. So we're on the tee, we're intent on watching that ball right on the tee, right? It doesn't change, we're just going to make it a little harder. We're going to make it more like a game. So what we're going to do, let me show you. What we're going to do is, here's how we are on the tee, we're focused, beautiful, and we're right ahead on the ball, and we should be looking at that when the ball is gone, right? So now what we're going to do is we're going to pretend that we're going to track the ball when it leaves the pitcher's hand. Pick it up when it's on the tee, and we'll see if we can achieve the same thing. Okay? So I'm going to step out and show you, and I'm going to step in and show you. So what we're doing is, we literally got it out here, we're watching the ball just like we would, then we'll come back and find the ball this way. Understand? Okay? So let's see if I can do it right. Alright, so I'm seeing the ball, now I'm going to follow the pitcher. You're a little shorter than me, I'm going to adjust. Okay, pitcher switches the ball, ball's up in the air. Right? Over the middle of the field. Very good. Looks like I know what I'm talking about. Now see, this is the easiest one. This is the best way of literally checking every single thing when you don't have anybody to pitch to. You understand? You're making it as close to a real wide pitch as you can when you're all by yourself. So that's why I call the advanced teach. Got to get the technique down statically on the tee first, like you did. We had to get through 6 or 8 balls, which was great. Sometimes it'll take 60 balls and you never even get to the advanced tees. That's okay. You might have a day where you're off. You might not ever get to the advanced tees of finding the ball. Stay on the tee. I'm usually, what I do is,
okay. Good question, good question. Yep.
What I normally do is if I can hit 7 or 8 balls out of 10, like I just hit, pretty pure. Take a break. 10 more balls. I'll do 10 balls. If I can do 2 sets where I hit 7 or 8 balls with the tee, then I'll go to advanced teach. If I don't take 2 sets in a row that I can get 7 or 8 balls out of 10 good, I never get to go to the next class. Right?
So I know sometimes I think sometimes I do that too.
So that's kind of what you were doing.
I think I felt that.
No, look, there's little tiny things. You coach the main basic fundamental things, but there's little tiny things. Like everybody's body's different, the shape of your hand's slightly different, your grip's up, you know. All those little tiny things are things that you identify about yourself in that little adjustment. Does it change any of the good fundamental things that we're after you? No, it does not. For you, is it enhancing that? Yes, it does. Right? It makes you feel more comfortable and confident to play. It's fine. It's not like you're saying, Alan, I feel so much better when I do this, when I hit the ball better. No, we're not talking about dumb stuff like that. We're talking about a slight little change that makes you feel more confident, gets you back in the right place. Yeah, fine. This guy's pretty good. He just hit a perfect line drive up the middle.
Like a golf swing, like that smooth.
That's what you want. Yeah. And then remember, as you build into this exercise, you can get a little bit more aggressive with how hard you're swinging the bat. I would say that's probably what, 70% there? Yeah, it's great.
This is where I tend to do better.
Well, that's the problem. Remember, the key phrase is controlled aggression. It's when we try to overswing sometimes, it's when we get out of control. how natural that feels? It's like almost effortless, which makes sense, right?
Yeah.
When your body posture is good, you shouldn't feel anything weird. You shouldn't feel any off balance. You shouldn't feel, you know, falling around when you're done swinging. None of that. Because you should have a good foundation that you're landing on, and all the rest should follow through. Swing and the ball is gone, you should still be looking at this where the guy was.
That's our objective.
As dumb as it sounds, sometimes you gotta step out of the box and remind yourself of the objective. See how important that little label is, that little label trick is? Because that's how intent, look, if you are following the ball in, and you find the ball here, and you swing it, but you're not intent on reading this, what are you doing? You're kind of looking at the zone of your ball, right? Are you going to hit it? Absolutely. But now we're talking about teaching focus. Teaching focus, okay? And it sounds little, but this is where it starts. This is where that starts, with little simple exercise like this. You don't have a lot of time at home, you can turn this tee around and bang balls into the fence and do the same thing. Or get a net and do it in your backyard.
Square with the ball, did you?
Half an inch.
Your head, remember, our head, what's in our head? Our eyes. Think about this. I'm glad you brought that up. But this is a logical thing, but unless I point it out, you might not have thought of it. Your eyes are in your head. Your head moves a long time to the wrong place. What kind of data is it feeding your hands? Is it correct data? If I need to be a millisecond, a milliinch on to get a hit, or is it incorrect? It's defective data. Now, at the last minute, I could possibly correct if my head came back to find the ball, but how many people do that? Up there right away. Because why? You're taking out the variable. What's the variable on a pitch? Where the pitch is, speed of pitch, height of pitch, all that. We're taking away the variable, making it as close to a real pitch as we can, especially when we do advanced teach. But it's a learning tool to help us dial in that we can't control that on the regular pitch. Understand? So T-work sometimes can be really huge. I like both, obviously, but there's T-work sometimes can really get you over. Time out. Bottom of seven, two outs. Batting first and second. Batting second and third. We're down two runs.
Second and third?
Yep. What is this, what is that gonna change for you right now?
Well, I should have known that by the time you said the when I was on deck already. But I need to keep that ball down two outs, right? And keep it down, pull it hard.
What else does it tell? I have to pull it hard? The answer to that question is nothing.
Nothing?
Why?
It's a trick question.
It's a trick question.
Well, that's why I was.
Okay, good.
Well, although, I said that.
No, let's get back to
the field and you want to know.
I'll give you all that. I'll give you all that.
One out, I'll get you a pitch of game.
I'll give you all that. Well, we know that a fly ball is not going to work because I said two outs, right? So we're going to get back to the very original thing. What is the object of the ball? So why is the answer to that question not? Is it changing what I'm trying to do here?
No, I'm just going to get hit.
I'm just going to get hit. That's exactly right.
In my head.
That's the psychology of it. But see, you have to train yourself. Not only do I teach how to hit, I tell you why and what to think and what not to think. We overthink things. We're our own worst enemy here. This gets in the way of our success here many times. Last 10 years, most of my studies have been on psychology, sports psychology. 30 years of athletics and how to hit, how to train and all that stuff. It's all great stuff. You know what I found out when I got older? A lot of that stuff starts to change because we're older. The psychology of hitting is the difference between being a good hitter and a great hitter also. But the strike, good hitter, great hitter, psychology, good hitter, great hitter. How many great hitters do we see but they're a guy who's set up and chokes? Right? He chokes. Guy that you don't want up in the seventh. It's 750. Put him in the seventh inning, he gets 400. You know guys like that? It's this. I can sit here for another 12 hours and talk to you about this. But that is the biggest thing I can tell you right now. The odds of the game never changes. You want to get a hit. Therefore, your approach to the box does not change. The thing is that got you sometimes in the last 5 seconds. Well, the only reason I say that's probably a hit is because you did it so poorly that it's not that funny. And all you did, what did you see what he did?
Looks like crap.
I'm gonna give you one picture.
What was that bad?
Not bad.
Well, he likes to
been digging in a little bit, I think, too, just to make a point.
Never say that I'm like that.
Well, it's like when you say, I'm going to show you bad things, like I'm really over-exaggerating. That's what I'm talking about. That
the reason
kind of
that you can say that is because it's true.
And one of the things I was telling him on the way up here, I don't know if you got it when you first started pitching. I said, you can tell me every pitch, if I did something wrong, what it was. I don't have a problem because your demeanor and the way you tell me is fine.
Number one, I just believe in having fun while you learn. Number two, I think being sarcastic sometimes can help you.
Kind of take the pressure off. Everybody can laugh at themselves a little bit when you do something silly, and then you relax. Yeah, refocus. Refocus on the things we just been talking about. Work. They get it. Almost exactly the same thing. That's a little bit of overaggression. That's all it is. But don't look. We set you up for failure. I he had no part of that. No, because here's another thing. Let's talk about psychology. Psychology of those situations. We always want to fix normal human response to the situation. We need to teach ourselves. Harness the energy. We get excited because we're professionals. Situation development. They just